Everybody ready?
Yeah.
All right, listen.
It's your weekend show.
Quiet, numbskulls, I'm broadcasting.
With Bob Biermann.
It's great.
And welcome to your weekend show. I'm your host, Bob Biermann. Today we begin a four-week special series to figure out if we are truly at the end of the line or are we entering a time of paganism. Stay tuned.
Well, it's all.
Someone to tell you everything. Sit around and wonder what tomorrow will bring. Maybe a diamond ring.
Well, it's all right, even if they say you're wrong. Well, it's all right. Sometimes you gotta be strong. Well, it's all right, as long as you got somewhere to lay. Well, it's
somewhere down the road away,
the end of the line.
You'll think of me and wonder where I am these days.
The end of the line.
Maybe somewhere down the road when somebody plays
the end of the line.
Purple haze.
Well, it's all right, even when push comes to shove.
Happy to feel that.
The end of the line.
And it don't matter if you're by my side.
The end of the line.
I'm satisfied.
Well, it's all.
Once again, I welcome you to your weekend show. I'm your host, Bob Biermann. As I said at the very beginning of the program, today we are entering a period of four weekends where I want to touch on some issues that have really been on my heart and my mind for quite a long time. These kind of programs take a little bit more effort to produce, a little bit more thinking, a little bit more work and energy. But from time to time, I think that we just need to get our common sense and our pragmatism together for just a moment to rationally think things through. As I told you, this month, if you've listened to the program before, I turned 65 in the middle of October. And in my 65 years, I've seen a lot of things. I've experienced a lot of life. I can remember what it was like to be a teenager thinking I knew everything about everything, and I knew more than my employers and my parents and my teachers. I get it. I used to be that guy. I really was that guy. I think all of us, to some degree, are. We begin to flex our muscles in our teen years. and we're growing up and we're changing so quickly, but we don't realize we don't have the life foundation quite yet to have had some experience in a lot of things. I was thinking the other day, I started my broadcast career when I was very young, and I was not just barely 16 when I first got on the air, which is kind of unheard of, but that's where I started. But I also remember when I was 16 going to an event that has been around ever since. And I remember it so well because as a young guy covering something that looks like a news story with a tape recorder for the first time in my life, I wasn't even quite 16 yet. And I covered what is known as Earth Day. 15 heading towards 16 with a tape recorder, listening to all the speeches about Earth Day 1970. And what kind of a world could we expect in 10, 20, or 30 years away? You know, when I was 16, the idea of the year 2000 seemed a million years away. I'd be 46 in the year 2000. And I'm thinking to myself, what would I look like at 46? Am I going to have gray hair? Am I going to be an old wrinkled man? But you know, those years flew by faster than I wish they had. And I can look back at all the experience of my life and realize that if you use your common sense, if you use your head, if you don't listen to the world in simple little sound bites all the time and go a little bit deeper, there's a lot of things about the issues that face the world today that are a little bit more complex and not as cut and dry as we think. Now, as I said, I've been thinking about doing this series of programs for a number of weeks. And I didn't know if I was going to wait till maybe November, but I'll go ahead and start now. What really triggered my mindset was a recent phenomenon we saw back during the month of September, just a couple of weeks ago. And I'm watching how the world is just enthralled by a 16-year-old girl from Sweden. Now, before you think I'm going to start just jumping all over her and criticizing her and everything else, no, not necessarily. I will criticize some of the things that she said, but I'm also convinced that what she said is what she was told and what she was taught. Because I have to go back to the time when I was 16. And how much did I know at that point? If I needed to write a paper, it didn't come from my knowledge or experience. It came from reading books and asking questions of others. I didn't have enough life experience to understand economics. I didn't have the life experience to understand the world in which I was now living and how we got from 1900 to 1970. I didn't even yet appreciate all the technology changes that had occurred from 1900 to the time that I'm now living as a 16-year-old. I really didn't have a reference point. And that's true with a lot of young people today. They haven't lived through life to question things that they've been told and to experience things for themselves to draw their own conclusions. More often than not, and myself, I include myself in this, at 16, our opinions are basically the opinions that we've been told to believe, have been led to believe, or our peers believe, and we find it easier to follow our peers than to do the work for ourselves. Let me say that again. I want you to get this concept clear in your mind. Once again, I understand Greta Thunberg's passion to save the planet. I get it. I understand her mindset. But I believe that she has been led astray and very deceived in what she has been told, what is happening. We hear nothing but predictions over and over and over again of the dire straits that our world is in. And how, if we don't do something now, we only have 10 years left. 10 years to what? 10 years to what kind of catastrophic event? I'm certain some of you are ready to send me an email to tell me what those events are, and you are firmly believing what you are being told that the consensus of science is. I doubt that there really is the consensus that we are often led to believe. I can tell you what the consensus was at Earth Day in 1970. I remember listening to speeches from professors and researchers on that day, on that first Earth Day, that had a boatload of science at their disposal, and research, and fossil digging, everything that you could possibly do. And they had some dire predictions for our world in 1970. And into the early and mid 1970s, we kept hearing this very mantra.
In 1977, the worst winter in a century struck the United States. Arctic cold gripped the Midwest for weeks on end. Great blizzards paralyzed cities of the Northeast. One desperate night in Buffalo, eight people froze to death in marooned cars. The brutal Buffalo winter might become common all over the United States. Climate experts believe the next ice age is on its way. According to recent evidence, it could come sooner than anyone had expected. At weather stations in the far north, temperatures have been dropping for 30 years. Seacoasts long free of summer ice are now blocked year-round. According to some climatologists, within a lifetime, we might be living in the next ice age.
Recent studies of ancient ice deposits and of underground layers of pollen from trees that lived 100,000 years ago suggest that last time, the final transition from a warm to an ice age climate happened incredibly fast. Not over thousands or even hundreds of years, but in less than 20 years. When the shift occurs, the climate in many regions of the Earth cools very quickly. Fruit and nut trees that need warm weather no longer grow in many temperate regions, and they are replaced by the kinds of trees now found only in areas like northern Sweden and Alaska. The glaciers will take many thousands of years to reach their maximum point, but the climate cools so suddenly that agriculture almost instantly becomes all but impossible in most regions of the Earth. Some recent evidence suggests that we may now be more than halfway through such a rapid, perhaps less than 20-year transition period, and that we may be less than 7 years away from the beginning of the next ice age.
But baby, it's cold outside.
Got to go
but
away.
Baby, it's cold outside.
This evening has
been hoping that you drop in. I'll hold your hands, they're just like I...
Maybe some of you remember those kind of headlines from the 1970s. And those headlines hung around all the way to the beginning of the 1980s. We heard over and over and over again, beginning in 1970 on Earth Day in particular, and all the way through the 1970s. We're running out of oil. We're going to have to turn our thermostats in the wintertime down to 67 or 68 and wear sweaters because we're running out of anything to burn to keep warm. And worst off is we're heading to a time of a global ice age. I remember specifically, and this is not an illusion of mine, this is not something I am making up, but it really sticks out in your mind, certain things that you hear in your lifetime. At that Earth Day in 1970, in that Earth Day with this expert from, I believe it was Cornell University or Princeton, it was one of the two universities. I remember there were speakers there from both. These were the climate experts of the day. And I remember him telling us that if we as mankind don't do something right now, if we don't take drastic action today, immediately, we don't have 10 years. How many times have we heard this? We only have 10 years to do something, or it's everlastingly, everlastingly too late. Like I say, I know some of you are disagreeing with me and you're ready to write me a letter and tell me that I don't know what I'm talking about, but I can give you what I've observed in the 49 years since Earth Day 1970. And I'm going to give you a list of all the predictions made over these past, oh, I don't know, almost 50 years. And then you can judge for yourself the credibility of so many of the claims that have been made to date about this world that we live. I don't profess to be some kind of scientific expert. You don't have to be to observe that everything you've been told has not worked out the way they claimed it would. This research scientist said that somewhere between the late 80s into the 90s and by no later than the year 2000, snowfalls, the type you would see in most of Pennsylvania or Ohio, would become commonplace in Miami Beach because the world was going to get super cold. And because of this super cold environment, we wouldn't be able to grow food. And people, because of all the cold weather, would starve to death. We would be in the Ice Age, dealing with glaciers again. And guess what? Here's what I want you to take away just for the moment. Remember, this is what we were told then. We'll address in a few minutes what we're being told now. We were being told then that the reason we were coming into this very rapid and this very sudden ice age was because of mankind. And we were 100% to blame for this unprecedented rapid descent into a global ice age, and we only had 10 years. We only had 10 years to address the problem before it would be irreversible. You know, when I was 16 years old and I heard that, I truly believed it. I mean, why would I doubt what I'm being told? Why would I question people that are learned scientists with dozens or decades worth of experience behind them? Why should I? I believed every word that they said. And honestly, it's one of the reasons that I moved from upstate New York to Georgia and South Carolina in the 1970s. Because I didn't like the cold weather of upstate New York. Honestly, I moved south to get away from the winters near Rochester, New York, and Lake Ontario, literally believing they were going to be getting increasingly worse. And, you know, I'm living in the South and I'm watching these specials. You just heard the voice of Leonard Nimoy talking about the coming global ice age. I remember that on television. It was 1977, 78, somewhere in there, probably 1978. Thinking, wow, here we are in the South. We're going to be getting a New York type winter before long, but I think I can endure it. And something changed along the way. Something happened to change the narrative. And what I think happened was, as time went on and all the dire predictions were not occurring as promised, it was safer to be quiet for a while and let it all fade into people's memory. You know, there's something I have learned, and it's more true today than it was even 30, 40 years ago. People have incredibly short memories. They'll tell you this in politics. All you need is a few months between a bad event and an election, and you can erase that bad event because people's memories are short. They live in the soundbite world we have created since the 1980s. They only go with today's information, and they ignore a wealth of long-term knowledge. You know, I've said this before in the program. I'm going to say it again because it's going to be something that's going to be a theme over these next 4 weeks. There is a difference between knowledge and wisdom. Knowledge is essentially a pile of facts. Wisdom is knowing how to discern those facts to get an accurate and correct answer. You can cherry pick facts all you want and draw any conclusion you desire. For me, I'm just looking at a 50-year track record of the things that I have seen from people that made a lot of sense to me at the time. And now here I am at 65 years of age wondering, why did some of the things they said, or really all of it, never happen? And people get mad at me when I say I'm a little bit skeptic. They'll yell at me, you climate denier, you this, that, and the other, you're just a fool. And I'm going, you're believing stuff that for 50 years the predictions have yet to come to pass. And I want to share those before the program is out today. But we live in a unique time. We're being told that our planet is in peril. This is your weekend show, and I'm your host, Bob Bierman. Like I say, this program is a little different today, and you may disagree with what I have to say, and that's fine. You are also entitled to your opinion. And you can challenge that opinion, and you can contact the program by going to yourweekendshow.com. That is yourweekendshow.com. And you can send me a message or an email. By the way, if you write to Bob at yourweekendshow.com, that's Bob at yourweekendshow.com, those emails come directly to me. There is no secretary or anybody in between. I'll read your message, and there's a good chance I'll even reply. And you can tell me all about the science that I'm ignoring. But I'm going to tell you the failed predictions of 50 years, none of which, not one of these predictions have ever come true. Now, if you gambled on the horses in a place like New York State, and if you had a guy that gave you tips on betting on horses, and for 50 years, every horse he told you would win lost, and you kept losing money, why would you keep coming back to the same guy to get advice on the horses? One of the issues we need to really, really define for ourselves, and this is utterly and absolutely important, who benefits? Who is the benefit? Who benefits from what we talk about climate change today? Who benefited 50 years ago, 30 years ago, 20, 25 years ago, 10 years ago? And those are questions that have to be asked. And then we have the young lady, and like I say, I'm not here to criticize her per se, but I am criticizing those that have fed her the information and put her out there in front of the United Nations, that bought her over on this carbon neutral boat. It was a big show, a big deal. You know, she, in her statements, talks about, you've stolen my childhood. And I'm looking at her in some pictures taken on her voyage across the Atlantic in that marvelous multi-million dollar boat. And I'm thinking, man, I wish I had had that childhood. And everybody says how wonderful it is because she came over and showed us the way we could be carbon neutral, yet her staff and all of our other support help, they were on airliners. They don't talk about that part. We're going to talk about what she had to say. And then I'm going to explain to you where the sourcing of so much of what she has to say comes from. And it's going to be, for a lot of you, from an unexpected source. This is your weekend show, and I'm your host, Bob Bierman.
Don't know why there's no sun up in the sky. Stormy weather since my man and I ain't together. Keeps raining all the time. Together, I'm weary all the time, the time, so weary all the time. When he went away, the blues walked in and met me. If he stays away, I know old rocking chair is gonna get me. All I do is pray the Lord up above will let me walk in the sun once more. I can't go on. Everything I had is gone. Stormy weather. My man and I ain't together. Keeps raining all the time. Keeps raining all the time. When he went away, you know, the blues walked in and met me. If he stays away, old rocking chair will surely get me. All I do is pray the Lord up above will let me walk in the sun just once more and go on. Everything I had is gone. Stormy weather. Since my man and I, well, we ain't together. Keeps raining all the time. Keeps raining all the time.
On the air and online at yourweekendshow.com with Bob Bierman.
Once again, welcome back to your weekend show. I'm your host, Bob Bierman. I like that version of Stormy Weather. Brings back some memories for some of our audience. It goes back to probably when I was a very, very young child. That version by Lena Horne in Stormy Weather. And we do live in a very stormy and turbulent time. In our politics, in the way we treat each other, in the world that we have today. But, and this is what we'll be getting into over the next several weeks beyond this program today, is what is the source of this angst? What is the source of the anger? What is the source of the things that truly trouble us? And we're going to get into that in the weeks ahead. And I think as we begin to peel back the layers of the onion, you'll begin to see what I'm talking about. Too often, most of us live in what I call a superficial world. And all of us, and I will include myself, can be guilty if we're not careful about just following today's series of new sound bites. Little bits and pieces of information. One of the good things about today's technology, and one of the bad things about today's technology, we have all this information at our fingertips. And if we just skim the headlines, we don't really get the story. I remember one thing about my childhood that is different than a lot of my own peers for a long time. And maybe it's because I was going into media, my interest. I used to read the newspaper a lot. Remember those things that came to your house in 3 and 4 sections? I used to read the newspaper, and I tried to grasp and understand this world around me from the time I was 10 or 11. And as I got into high school, it all began to make some more sense because I had more life experience and more reading and talking to people like my father and my grandparents that had lived life and could put some of the history, the recent history, into perspective for me. Their feelings and how things impacted their life. Today, many of our young people don't realize how controlled, this goes for adults too, how controlled the information we seek truly is. In today's modern lexicon, we have the term Google it if you want to find something out. Just go to Google, ask Google. And Google will tell you everything you need to know about any topic. Well, let me tell you something. That may be true to a point. But Google has made algorithm decisions to tell you what you need to think and what stories you need to see first. A lot of people don't go to page 4, 10, or 14 on a topic. They just see the first stories on that first page in a Google search. And so the other day, there are several different search engines out there, and I came up with a particular topic. And I did a little research, and I compared the results on Google to 3 other search engines. Google's response on certain issues is 100% uniform for the first page or two. They pretty well decide what you need to know. Others gave multiple opinions of the same topic. And the more potentially political a topic is, the more Google will steer you in a singular direction. I think a lot of you have figured that out. Now, for some of you, you're happy about that because it's the direction you believe. But is that the direction that is truth? We live in a very changing world. That's been one of the overriding themes of your weekend show since it started back in 2015. And it's hard to believe we will finish up 5 years of broadcasting this program early next year. And we've talked about what direction should this program go. And I'm giving it a lot of thought. Programs like today may be something we need to do. Take some time to to learn about this world in which we live. But let's go back to a couple of weeks ago. We started hearing about this climate change activist from Sweden, who is a 16-year-old girl. Her name is Greta Thunberg. And for some reason, this 16-year-old has become an overnight and instant media sensation. Now, let me ask this question, and I'm asking this legitimately. I mean, this is a serious question. Don't laugh it off. How did she suddenly become the face of climate change? How did she become overnight the face that the world is going to be dead and gone in 10 or 12 years if we don't do anything? Where did Greta get all of her wisdom to say the things that she says? And what gave her standing to come to speak and basically yell at all the leaders in the United Nations? I mean, that's a legitimate question. You know, Greta lives in one of the healthiest and wealthiest times in world history. She talks about her childhood being ruined. And I'm thinking, man, I wish I could have taken that boat ride across the Atlantic that she did. What a lifetime experience. What do you mean you've stolen her dreams and childhood? This is a gal that has been taking every Friday off to protest climate change. And she's 16. But Greta is no different than millions of other indoctrinated children of her age. They act like they live in this uniquely destroyed world on the absolute doorstep of total disaster. And they don't have enough life experience to understand otherwise. The truth is, and you know it and I know it, a bunch of adults with an agenda have spent over a year creating this particular 16-year-old because her soundbites, remember we talked about soundbite world, completely agree with the belief system of certain people. And they understood the concept, how can you criticize a 16-year-old girl who is so blunt? You know, even CNN called her, you know, this child with this young age. She had this age-appropriate grasp of the world, whatever that means. You know, you need to understand that in the last several years, we have 30% of the people believing, 30% of voters in the United States believe that it's somewhat likely the Earth will become uninhabitable in 10 years. And humanity could be wiped out in 10 or 15. And more than half of the voters that are under 35 believe that as well. Think about that for a moment. This has been a pretty noble cause for the last, almost 20 years. To indoctrinate our children. I remember back in 1989... And I do promise to get to something that Greta said, and we're going to talk about it. I remember in 1989, we were told by the United Nations in no uncertain terms, there was no open discussion going to be on this particular topic, that mankind was destroying the planet. And we had less than 10 years before billions, with a B, billions of people would be dead and entire continents would be wiped out. We had 10 years. That's what they said 30 years ago. We were told temperatures would continue to rise, and truthfully, if you're honest, you'll find out they really haven't. Do the research. Don't take the soundbite. I have done that. And once you get past all the nonsense that's commonly sourced at the beginning of Google, you find out that this obsession with living in Armageddon is a common theme. Like I said, we're going to get into what I think are the deep underlying causes. But you know, you have Greta coming to the United Nations, and you have her telling the United States, much of Europe, that somehow we have to change things or the world will die, yet she kind of ignores China, India, and other places. You know, places that are, or how about the continent of Africa? There are many nations that are trying to dig their way out of an impoverished life. And she has now become the face of what I consider a pagan cult. This Guyanaism of Mother Earth. You know, we've spent 25, 30 years trying to use our educational systems in the public school sector to mock the belief of many Christian kids and replace it with literally ancient paganism of worshiping the earth. And as a result, this is the kind of conversation we get today, as we heard a couple of weeks ago at the United Nations.
You have stolen my dreams and my childhood with your empty words, and yet I'm one of the lucky ones. People are suffering, people are dying, entire ecosystems are collapsing. We are in the beginning of a mass extinction, and all you can talk about is money and fairy tales of eternal economic growth. How dare you?
There you have it. That's what 16-year-old Greta Thunberg said to the United Nations about 2 weeks ago, that we have 10 years left, and we've stolen her childhood. We've destroyed her dreams. What dreams? She's had a pretty good childhood. From what I'm seeing, she's been made a celebrity, a star. She's done a lot of things that a lot of people would love to be able to do. And somehow we are told that everything she says needs to be accepted as absolute fact and gospel. And if you don't believe every word this young girl just said, you're hateful, you're despicable. You're a climate denier. You don't get it. Let me tell you something. I told you that I'm 65 years old now. And unlike a lot of my own peers from my own generation, I actually like to apply a little sense of history, a little common sense to the things that I hear. Dire predictions or a dime a dozen. And let me tell you something. If those that have listened to this program, you know that I've gone after false Christian teachers and prophets, and they're cashing in on the gloom and doom of the apocalypse and their interpretation of Revelation and what have you. There are a ton of frauds out there on the radio and television that need to be systematically ignored because their prophecies have never come true. And the same is true with the same crowd that has put this new figurehead up to the world that must be believed. You know, I guess I was in maybe junior high when we first started hearing oil would be gone in 10 years. That's like 1966. We were told that there'd be a dire famine and billions dead by 1975. We were told that overpopulation would kill off billions. You heard this in 1968. We even heard that everybody would disappear in a cloud of blue steam by 1989. We would use up all of our natural resources by the 1990s. Urban citizens would have to have a gas mask to survive in 1985, and that may be true in China, parts of India, but it's not a worldwide phenomena. You know, we were told in 1970 that a nitrogen buildup would make all land unusable and unable to be farmed. In 1970, Earth Day, we were told we'd be in an ice age before the year 2000. In 1970, we were told without water rationing and food rationing, mankind would not survive till 1980. And as the temperatures didn't rise quick enough, then we talked about the new ice age by maybe, I don't know, 2010. We were told in 1972, I remember this, so I drove around in my little four-cylinder, no-air-conditioned car with no radio, that we'd be out of oil by 1990. We were told in 1974 our new space satellites were showing that the ice age would be here any day. There was a total consensus of scientists that the planet was getting colder and famines and death were imminent. 1978, we're told that there's not a chance that we can get away from this cooling trend. 1980, we were told that acid rain would kill all life in lakes within 10 years. Then in 1980, we were told we'd run out of oil by the year 2000. You know, you can look at rising sea levels. We were told in 1989 that because of man, rising sea levels would obliterate nations if nothing was done. And these nations would be underwater by the year 2000. We were told that New York City would be underwater long before now. We were told in 2000 it would only be a matter of a couple of years before children don't even know what snow is anywhere in the United States. We were told we'd have a famine in 10 years if we don't give up eating fish, meat, and dairy products. We were told that in 2000, that we had 10 years. Notice it's always this 10 or 15-year cycle. And for the big stuff, they got to push it off 50. Outside of your lifetime. To make you feel guilty that you're going to be condemning to a horrible world your children and grandchildren. We were told, I remember this in 2005. In 2005, we had Hurricane Katrina hit New Orleans and caused a tremendous amount of death and devastation. I want you to understand something right now. Let's get this very clear right now. A lot of what happened in New Orleans in terms of the death and destructions and flooding could have been avoided. It's amazing that the sea levees built by the French in the 1700s worked. And the ones that are controlled and built by a very corrupt government failed. I would like to know where all those billions of federal tax dollars to keep the levee system in New Orleans functioning went. We found out a lot of parties, a lot of trips, a lot of conferences. And right after Hurricane Katrina, we were told, and this I remember specifically because I was doing on-air radio at the time, and I listened very closely and I kept a lot of news clippings, that this would be the beginning that every year, henceforth, going forward, we would have a ton of super hurricanes bigger than Katrina each and every year. And the frequency and the power of these hurricanes would exponentially grow every hurricane season. And what happened? We had a 12-year hiatus of no hurricanes. And a couple of the ones we've seen, like Dorian, may or may not be record setters because prior to the 1970s, we didn't have the satellite technology we have today. We didn't even count all the storms that came across the Atlantic. We had no way. There was one not long ago churning out there in the Atlantic that never affected anything that would have been unnoticed back in the 1960s and even 1970s, unnamed, uncounted, because we didn't have the technology. So the super hurricanes really didn't materialize. If you look at it over a 50 or 60 year span, they're running about the same. You know, we were told that the entire Arctic would be ice-free by 2018. Did it happen? We were told that in 2008. We had 10 years and we didn't do anything. The Arctic would be ice-free and parts of Florida, New York City underwater. We were told in 2009 we had 96 months left to save the world or it would be everlastingly too late. That's 7 years. We were told in 2009 we had 50 days to save the planet from catastrophe. 50 days if we didn't act now and pass some carbon taxes. Well, the Arctic ice-free that didn't happen was re-predicted to happen by 2015 and failed. You know, when you look at this list, and that's just a handful of the failed climate prophecies, I give Greta some credit. She did an outstanding job of reading the lines that these adults have carefully written and trained her to do with all the facial expressions, with all the emotion, and with all the anger to tell us that we have only 10 years, 10 years before it's everlastingly too late. You know, if you listen to what she said, she was talking in terms of, and all you can think about is the money and economic growth. And she, in that regard, is right. But what about the money and economic growth is killing the planet? Because we've been doing this for a long time. Let me give you something else I remember from the 70s. I can remember in the early 1970s, that for the second time in about 20 years or so, that a part of the Cuyahoga River in Ohio had caught fire. Now, obviously, that was some pollutants that are floating on the top of the river near some of the industrial plants that you'd find between Akron and Cleveland at the time, because this lake empties into Lake Erie. That is the Cuyahoga River. And those people back, I remember this so well, said this river and its ecosystem and the life it contained and the shore and its life would be dead, thoroughly dead for 10,000 years. Let me repeat that. The experts, and I remember reading this in the Cleveland Plain Dealer. I had moved to Ohio right after that, and they were talking about how they're going to try to clean it up, but it's going to be dead, ecologically dead, for 10,000 years. Back in 2014, I happened to be in Ohio, and I happened to see the Cuyahoga River. It is teeming with life. We keep forgetting this planet is a living planet. And I will say from my faith background, it's a tribute to a living God. We are arrogant enough to think that we control everything. And we don't. We don't. You know, in order for Greta Thunberg's fairy tale reality of fixing the climate, if it was to be adopted, that would mean the end of improvements in agriculture. It would mean the end of so many of the things that we've come to expect. You know, let me tell you something. It puts your cell phone in danger because the batteries, there's more economic harm done to the earth pulling up these batteries. There's a fascinating report that discusses, and I got into it deeper than some of the memes you see on Facebook. While some windmills will generate power, some will actually have a negative impact because they will never generate as much power as it took to make many of the windmills. Now, how does that make any sense? Not every one of them, but a significant number will never produce back the energy it took to make them. So what's the point? People like Greta need to understand, if you want to live in this barrenized world to save it, as you claim we must, then be prepared to give up your cell phone. When it's over, it's over. You can't have it. There are many things you've come to expect you will not be able to have. You keep asking for action, but do you know what those actions truly mean? You said it over and over again in your speech to the United Nations.
There will not be any solutions or plans presented in line with these figures here today, because these numbers are too uncomfortable, and you are still not mature enough to tell it like it is.
We are now dealing with a 50-year proven track record of predictions that have failed. And Greta claims that all the adults are not mature enough to understand what she does. All she understands is what she has been told, because she doesn't have a lifetime of experience to see the hundreds of times we have been lied to as we begin to advance a new type of paganism, Guyanaism, and Moloch worship. You know, there's nothing new under the sun. The spirit of Antichrist is already here. And that's the topic for next weekend's show. Until next week, don't forget the website, yourweekendshow.com. That is yourweekendshow.com. And until next week at the same time, may God richly bless you.
It's hot in December, cold in July. When it rains, it pours out of a poisonous sky. In California, the body counts keep getting higher. It's evil out there, man, that state is always on fire. It's just been a hard day on the planet. How much is it all worth? It's getting harder to understand it. Things are tough all over on Earth.
On the air and online at yourweekendshow.com with Bob Biermann.